pessoal de Kisbika ao Cristina Ribeiro. Cristina Ribeiro, also a PhD in Diplomatic from the University of Lisbon, and she is also a professional of diplomatic engineer at the Faculty of Engineer of Oporto. Then we have Frederico Silveira, and I'm very pleased to present Frederico because he was one student of our school, and it's nice and important to have students that continue to research and to continue to maintain interest in the subjects that we deal in our school. And then at the end, we're going to have Catarina Rui, and she has a master in the Faculty of Architecture of Oporto, and she's making a PhD research in Lisbon. So at the end, I'm going to talk and then to moderate the debate, and now I present Cristina to add to the conference. Thank you.
First of all, thank you very much for inviting me. It's not common for someone from the Faculty of Engineering to be invited here, so I hope I will bring something useful to you. I'm with Inesh Tech, which is that's my research unit, by the way. So Inesh Tech is involved in many areas of research, from communications to health to power systems to sensor systems, and I'm that's my research unit. My commission was to talk a bit about ontologies. It's not easy to. I was talking with Tasso just a minute ago, and it was saying I don't know what's that of an ontology, but maybe I'm doing that as well, and probably is. So I try to put the whole thing a bit in context and start with a bit of why our main issue is complexity, and introduce the notion of computational thinking, and then go into ontologies which are actually part of what is traditionally called knowledge representation in artificial intelligence, by the way. Another sort of buzzword in the making, which is linked up and later. And I talk a bit about the area where I'm applying ontologies, to give you an idea of things that are actually being done. And to start with, I start with a quote about complexity, because in computer science, complexity is a big issue. There is lots of hard theory on mathematics and computer science about the issue of complexity, because it's crucial to computing. What can you compute? What can you compute effectively? I thought it was interesting that other people in other areas, completely different, were thinking that complexity is a big issue now. And as you see, we are surrounded by these buzzwords of big data everywhere, right? So the issue of how we can deal with the complexity of the world in all aspects, and of all the data that is now being collected in amounts which were not used to, is part of the context of what I'm talking about. And about complexity and computers, I would like to, maybe everybody knows that the word computer was first used for people. The first computers were people, not machines. So and they were mostly women, by the way. And the first occurrence of the computer in the New York Times, I think it was in 1892, and it was an ad looking for someone with competence in mathematics. So this is much later. It's by the time of the war efforts. And this is one of the first computers, the ENIAC, and two of the six women which were the first programmers of the computer. By the time programming had a lot of tables going one way and another in big rooms. And by the way, they were not given credit when the computer was presented. So I like to tell the story. Well, computers talked about a lot of thinking about how we can manage this this complexity of the world. And I like this. I like this notion that has been introduced by someone from Carnegie Mellon of computational thinking. So not the computation, not jumping right to computing as a thing done by computers, but the computation is something that frames the way we think about problems and about the world. And we see that nowadays we see computing everywhere. And sometimes you see in these areas people just feel they are being pushed by the computer people, taking them away from their place. And that's not the real picture. The real picture is that, at least as many people in computer science see it, is the need for everybody to take advantage of things that came from computing, the many notions that were developed for computation, but which are very useful for framing the way we think about problems. And so you see in all areas. So now you hear about machine learning and data mining and things like that, which bring people from statistics together with people from computing. You see that biology, you can't do anything in biology without computing. And the economics and so on and so on. And so computational thinking is a notion which defends that computing has changed the way that we think about the problems. And I recommend this. This is a very short paper by Janet Wing in the Communications of the ACM. And it's very interesting because it shows you this point of view of computing as something that should be a basic skill for people in their everyday life. And so not things like if you want to compute, you need to program. No, it's more like you need to think in an abstract way. And as I'm talking today about things which are actually abstractions, I think that's a useful way of introducing my topic, and that's why I brought this here. I think these things are interesting for people who may want to have a look at how people from computer science see the other areas and the rest of the world. And my next buzzword, so to speak, is knowledge representation. Because ontologies and semantic web, that's where ontologies fit, are a natural continuation of an area which is active since the 60s, which is artificial intelligence, which included a big issue, knowledge representation. So artificial intelligence is, so to speak, an area, a sub-area of computer science, which is concerned with how we can automate reasoning, how we can do automatically things that people are good at and machines used not to be. So how we can play chess by machines. By the way, they are very good right now. How we can translate language automatically. That's getting pretty good as well. So all these activities depend heavily on how we represent our knowledge. So if you want to translate, what are you going to do? build syntactic structures that, that capture the structure of discourse in one language and map them into these structures in another language? Maybe. Maybe use lots of statistics and lots of pattern matching. That's also the trend in language translation. So knowledge representation is an area, a traditional area in artificial intelligence, and it's that's where ontologies and knowledge representation with ontologies build upon. And of course, this is not new. So we can go back to Aristotle, and the knowledge representation goes back that far. But knowledge representation in artificial intelligence typically involved or can be separated in these three areas. Logic is typically the undisputed underlying representation for any knowledge. You need to be able to do inference, and inference is naturally captured in the logic reasoning. And you need rules of inference for your logic. And then ontology. That's where you decide what you'll be reasoning about. So ontology comes from philosophy. The part of philosophy concerned with the being, what is there to be analyzed and thought about. So when we say I'm defining the ontology for my problem, that means simply that I'm deciding what are the important concepts, how they relate to each other, and if you want to compute with that, then you have to represent that in a way that it can be manipulated, reasoned over. And that's where ontologies come about. And so logic, ontology, computation. So we don't just want to decide on the beautiful concepts that we'll be dealing with and how they relate. We also want to infer, to work on those concepts and extract logical consequences. That's the goal of automatic reasoning, so to speak. And the trend from knowledge representation to the so-called semantic web, I put there just the goal of the semantic web as it is stated in the W3C, the worldwide consortium which manages the standards and recommendations for web technologies. The semantic web has been the expression has been introduced in 2000 by Berners-Lee, the inventor of the web, as a so-called web of data. So the difference from the web, traditional web, is that the traditional web is aimed at people. So we find documents and pages and things like that. We navigate and we understand the contents, but on the semantic web, you want the contents to be understandable by machines. So you need to make the semantics of the content more explicit. That's what it's all about. And the semantic web is full of technologies, so somehow people tend to think that semantic web is lots of technology, lots of engineering, but at the core, is semantic, so it's conceptual, and it's a way of people capturing the knowledge in a way that can be shared and that can be used by very diverse applications. And these are the references to two papers that on the Scientific American, the one that introduced the expression semantic web, and another one which brought the inaction part, so the applications that were being built on the semantic web. But of course, the semantic web has lots of technologies, and if you want a slide full of acronyms, that's the one. You find lots of versions of this slide. It has been introduced, I think, by Berners Lee as well. This one has been imported from a presentation. But what is essential here, and I would like, this is all acronyms and things and technologies which are actually defined in documents which have been developed by committees and so. But the essential part here is that this is something which the goal of this stack of technologies is actually to make the applications there at the top quite free from getting locked in vendor-dependent formats and standards. So the idea in the semantic web is to keep all this available to everybody to explore and interlink. And I think one interesting part here is that it starts very low here on the gray part with things which are quite basic. What do you need if you want to make sense of a file? First of all, you need to understand the character codes in which the file is, in which the bits in the file are aligned. So if you don't get to understand the characters in the file, nothing, you can do nothing, right? So it starts there. It starts with, you have to understand, and so there is a standard for that. There's Unicode that allows you to use very different alphabets and character coding and still understand what's going on. And another essential part is you need to give names to things. So that's where URIs, which are getting back nowadays IRI, like internationalization, are identifiers for resources. So everybody is used to URLs. Those are locators on the web. URIs are a bit more ambitious. Things don't have to be on the web, but you have to have a name, a way to name them, to give them identifiers. And URLs are a good, because they are distributed. If I have my own domain, I generate how many identifiers I need. I just define them as it pleases me, and it's a way that in that way everybody can have an identifier which depends on their own domain and which does not collide with anyone else's. So identification and understanding the character codes are there at the bottom, because if you don't have that, you can't go any further. And then there's XML. Everybody knows a bit about what an XML or an HTML document looks like. Well, with this is here for easy parsing. We want to make it easy to understand the parts of a file. So you already understand the characters. Now I want to understand that here is the beginning of a name and here the name is over. Okay, so when I'm automatically looking at that file, I can extract the name which is there, or extract a block of text, or extract an image, right? So that's another basic level. And then you start with the actual semantic web stuff. So RDF is already a semantic web recommendation, it's not the standard, but and OWL there, the ontology language, another level. And why do we want all those things? Well, we want to make queries on that. So I need a language to interrogate, to make sense of my data and answer queries that someone has on that paper. Is there anybody which is related by this works with relationship with this person I'm looking for? If there is, I can query with Sparkle on the semantic web representation. So this is actually a technology stack, but underlying this technology stack, there are all the needs, all the conceptual needs that we there are sort of requirements for our understanding of the world. And this is already, let me jump a bit to the RDF part here. So RDF is a very simple, this is from the documentation on the W3C documentation. RDF is a very simple model. And it's very simple because very simple is good enough for capturing any knowledge that you can capture automatically. So everything I can say between two entities, Bob there, Alice, the Mona Lisa, I can say it with binary assertions. So Bob is a person, Bob is born on, Bob is interested in. Those are just assertions, and they constitute a sort of very basic way of making statements about the world. And but these statements are quite easy to capture also formally. So this is a graph, but this graph can be very easily turned into something, well, it's called triples. When you hear about semantic web, you always hear about triples. Triple stores instead of databases. Triple stores are simply stores where you have assertions in three parts. A subject, a predicate, and an object. And both the subject and the predicate and the object, they can have unique identifiers. Why is that interesting? Let me just show. Here, instead of the first graph, you have a graph where some of those nodes, this one is just a date, but that node here, there, it has a URI. So it has an identifier. And each node, which is not a simple literal, a simple value like a date, has an identifier. So for example, this is a documentary and it's on Europeana. So it's URI, it's on the Europeana domain. So that's the entity that's providing the identifier for that resource. And it's not only the nodes, also these relationships, birth date, type, topic interest, title, they also come from vocabularies which can be published and made available to others. That's one of the now we come to the ontologies. That's exactly where we come to the ontologies. I want to decide which verbs I use to talk about things. And I can do that because I can define my own ontology. And the other interesting part is I can mix and match and use my ontology together with other. So for example there, you have DC terms title for this entity, for example, is identified by a Wikidata identifier. It could be another one. And then you relate it with the name Mona Lisa with DC terms title. DC terms is a very well-known vocabulary. It's the Dublin part. It's used all over in libraries and other institutions because it's a very simple vocabulary developed for the web, by the way. And that's just the RDF. Of course, this graph is not the most interesting way for a computer to read, but this graph can be rendered very easily in a textual format, which is very easy to parse by a program, But it's also a requirement. I can also read that, right? Maybe it's not the more interesting interface for that information, but I can read that, and so can you. You can identify those pieces which start with description and with description and which are parts of that graph. So the interesting thing is the semantic web is aimed at machines, but it's aimed at both machines and people. So things are written in a way that's simple enough to be easily parsed by any machine, but it's also something which is not locked in a very hermetic format. It's something you can read yourself, like you do with HTML. But HTML is just display. It has no meaning for the components of the document. If you use a vocabulary that someone defined or that you defined yourself, then you can provide an explicit meaning for your data. And that's the goal of ontologies. Now I'm just providing instead of this, right? You can write all your ontologies like this in XML. But when you're defined an ontology, you're lucky enough to have tools that help you define your ontology very easily. And this is just an example of an ontology tool which is called Protégé. It's being developed in Stanford, and it allows you for example, define what kind of precision ontology for traveling. So it talks about accommodations and destinations, and in that ontology you can define the kind of objects that exist in your world, so that's ontology, and also what kind of relationships hold between those objects. So for example, here you're talking about some family destination, which is a subclass of destination. So I'm just browsing through the concepts in ontologies, classes. Classes help us define kinds of objects. So there's a kind of object which is accommodation, and there is another kind of object which is a destination. And I refine that with a family destination, saying that, a family destination has to have accommodations and activities and things like that. So you state a lot of what you know about those concepts. And then come the properties. And properties are things like as accommodation, as activity. So that relates, for example, a destination with an activity. In this destination, you can go to the beach, right? So you state things about the relationships between objects of several kinds. And for convenience, there are also so-called data properties, because they capture those simpler relationships where the object is just a literal. So if you just want to state that someone has a birth date, you don't need to create the birth date as an object. It's just a value. So that's captured with data properties. And this is practically what there is to know about designing an ontology. Anyone can take one of these tools and start designing an ontology for their domain. The interesting thing about ontologies is the way they can be combined. So ontologies operate on an open world assumption, which I'll talk in a minute. This is a beautiful picture which you can go to. If you just search for log link open data, you'll find this graph. This graph is interesting because it shows how the world is getting connected via these ontologies. They are in different colors because they are organized by domains. For example, the pin here, I think, is life sciences, and the green here, it's social networking. So there's a lot of that on Semantic Web. And the big node there is DBpedia, which is a project that has taken Wikipedia and transformed the information in Wikipedia into semantic web triples. So a knowledge which is easy to process by machine. So what you see there is a wealth of knowledge that people are capturing in several areas, and which is there to be picked. So you can just look for things that already have been defined by others and add to that. So the idea of the semantic web is that you can build on existing knowledge. Building on existing knowledge is an important concept here. And this graph gives you an idea of that. So there are so many things already there, and this is just these are just the bigger words. So to be on this graph, you have to be highly connected and have a certain volume in your models. And so it gives you a picture of the world of the open there should have some. Thing about, because sometimes those data sets which are there are not really open. You have to ask someone for them or get permission. It's not all completely open, but that's another issue. They are open enough to be found. And I'm just mentioning how, so that you think, you may think that I'm just always talking about semantic web. No, we are really doing things on the semantic web. I work on research data management, which is capturing information on data which is generated in research contexts. For example, examples there: fracture mechanics. That's something from our colleagues from the mechanical engineering. Analytical chemistry, biodiversity. That's the contact we have with people from CBO. And the problem is people are generating in research lots of interesting data, but then it's very difficult for other people to get to that data and reuse it and use it in their own research. And nowadays, projects, funded projects, are requiring you to deposit your data. And most people don't even know how to do that. And so what we are doing is building tools that can help people prepare their data so that it will be ready to go to a data repository. So more and more people will get credit, not just for writing the paper, but for publishing the data associated with the paper. In some areas, you have to deposit the data, otherwise your paper will not even be accepted. And we did this with ontologies. And what I want to show you here is those ontologies up there, Friend of a Friend, Dublin Core, Serif, they are ontologies which already were there. So we just put them. We use Dublin Core, we use a Friend of a Friend, because they already defined interesting verbs for us. And then, of course, if we want to describe very well an experiment made with wood fracture, for example, from our colleagues in mechanical engineering, you need specific verbs to talk about the experiment. And so we define domain ontologies. And all this works together in an application that helps people to prepare their data to be published. And what we always say about our system, which is called Bedrock, is that it's ready to be thrown away. And that's how all applications should be. They should all be ready to go away. But you shouldn't throw away the baby with the bathwater, right? So we want to keep the ontologies, and we want to keep the data, and we want to keep the description that you made of that data. And the description of the data, the metadata, that's the hard part. That's the part that people, well, I have to sit and write down my metadata. And well, we are also working around that, but I so if anyone here has interesting data that they want to publish, they should talk to me. I'm always picking people from different areas. So this is the image of what we are doing. We can say that we work on digital preservation because our goal is to make that data generated in a research context to live beyond beyond the computer of the PhD student who collected them. That's the typical thing. When the PhD student goes away, the computer is old and everything goes to the garbage. And what we are building is that's just an application, right? What I'm talking about here is just our application of ontologies. We use ontologies so that intermediate platform can collect the data and the metadata and publish all that in a public repository. And then, well,